Hello, this is Dr. Jim Thomas, and I want to welcome you to Fayetteville First Baptist Online. My hope and prayer for you today is that you're encouraged in your faith and challenged to walk toward a Christ-centered life. If you have any questions about today's message, or would like to have more information on what it means to follow after Jesus Christ, please don't hesitate to email me at info@fayettevillefbc.org. I hope you're encouraged today. May God bless you.
Good morning, church family. Good morning, we're glad you're here. Stand with us, let's sing together this morning.
Thank you. Thank you.
morning. Amen. Amen.
The next song that we're going to be singing is Have Thine Own Way. And Jesus doesn't require anything of us that he hasn't already been through. And when I was thinking about this song, I thought about Matthew 26:39, where he says, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me, but nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And I just think about that. When I think about this song, I'm asking the Lord to have his will in my life. I'm not asking for an easy thing. Christian living isn't an easy thing. And I know I can't do it on my own. And so I just pray scripture back to him that his strength will be made perfect in my weakness. So I just want you to think about that as we sing this next song.
Have thine own way, Lord.
Well, if you're paying attention during that introduction, you heard the pastor say that I'm really a small group guy, a Sunday school guy, more than a preacher. And I actually write Bible study lessons for a living. I'd argue I've written more Bible study lessons than anybody living or dead. And my Bible study lessons consist of about 20 questions. I like to say, if you can read 20 questions, you can lead a Bible study group. All right. And so I'm going to start today with a question that I like to invite you to think about. And the question is this: is Christian living easy or hard? And I want to get a response here. I'm going to ask it again, then I want you to respond. You ready? Is Christian living easy or hard?
Hard.
All right. Let's look at what did Jesus say. Jesus said, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light." My yoke is, what's that next word?
Easy.
Jesus said, following me, my yoke, when you put my the path of following me around your shoulder, it's going to be
easy.
It's hard for you to say, isn't it? and to make you feel a little bit better, by the way, that's the way everybody answers the question. I've asked that question to many, many groups over the years, and everybody always answers that question the same way, that our experience is that following Jesus is hard, when in fact Jesus said it will be easy. And I want to talk to you today, and if you will listen and pay attention and apply what we talk about today, I want to talk to you about today about how Christian living can get a whole lot easier. You ready? All right. Now, just by the way, this is actually a Sunday school training, leader training weekend, and so we're going to do a little teaching today. But then I also want to give a few little teacher tips along the way to our teachers. And one of those has to do with an introduction. And I think that the introduction to your teaching ought to answer the question, why should I listen to you today? Do not assume that your people want to listen, and answer the question early on. Focus your teaching around one big idea, and then early on answer the question and say to your people, it's not the only way to give an introduction, but it's a really good way and tried and true, and you can use it nearly every week. If you will listen to me today, here is the benefit you'll receive. And I want to say to you, if you will listen to me today, Christian living is going to become a whole lot easier. And to get us there, let's talk for a second about why it's hard. And I think the reason why it's hard for many of us is there's a misconception about Christian living. There is a common perception that Christian living is all about trying really hard to be good. People inside and outside the church think that Christian living is about trying hard to be good. And two mistakes we make in teaching, by the way, is sometimes we just teach for information, not teach for application. And you ought to always teach for application, teaching people how to obey. Not just teaching them information, but teaching them how to obey. But when we teach for application, if we're not really careful, we end up just saying, all right, here is a message on prayer, so try really hard to pray. And here is a teaching on giving, so try really hard to give. And here is a teaching on service, so go out and try really hard to serve. And I want to say to you, that is not the Christian life. Amen? I was hoping for an amen there. Let's try that again. That is not the Christian life. Amen? That is not the gospel. Charles Stanley, in his book on the Holy Spirit, on living the Spirit-filled life, says, for too many believers, the Christian life boils simply down to this, doing the best they can. Is that your understanding of Christian living? If that is your understanding of Christian living, I got some really, really good news for you. It's about to become a whole lot easier as a result of what we're going to look at today. He goes on to say, there is no power or distinction that sets them apart from the way everyone else in the world lives. The good that they can do can be attributed to their own discipline. And Charles Stanley teases this out and talks about the fact that he's actually one of those people that for whom eating your vegetables and getting up early and exercising and so forth came fairly easily for him. Don't you hate people like that? And he said, for a long time, from one perspective, I thought Christian living was easy because they told me to pray and I prayed, and they told me to give and I gave, and they told me to serve and I served. But I came to realize I was tired all the time. And I came to realize this was not the gospel. This was not Christian living. It was not Christianity. It was bootstrap-ianity. It was just
trying to be good by your own bootstraps, just working hard at it. And he realized that is not the gospel. And in this book, he talks about, that quote is from the book, The Spirit-Filled Life. And he talked about the importance of living with the Spirit living in us. And that's a whole different topic we could talk about on another day. It's not going to be the topic we're going to talk about today. One of the challenges in teaching, as you know, is you have to kind of assume some things. And I'm going to kind of assume that we have some understanding of what it means to live the Spirit-filled life. And if you don't have any understanding of that, Google it. But my point is, we need to have that understanding. And just by the way, there's a whole nother understanding that you need to have, kind of a presupposition that I have. And that is, you understand what it means to be born again. And I want to just get real clear about that because if you're not careful, you could hear what I'm about to say in a minute and think this is just all about trying really hard to be good. And I assume that we have come to an understanding that we must be born again, that we must place our faith in Christ, our trust in Him. We must ask Him to forgive us of our sins, and we must repent of our sins, and we must enter into that relationship with Him. And on the basis of that relationship with Him, and on the basis of living this Spirit-filled life, we have the opportunity to do some things. And I can't get into what all the ins and outs of that, other than just to say that unless we have a foundational understanding about those things, we really can't get on to what we want to talk about today. But again, Charles Stanley says, the good that they can do can be attributed to their own discipline, determination, and devotion to God rather than God's activity in their lives. I meet believers, Charles Stanley says, I meet believers all the times whose doctrine can be summed up in two statements. Nobody's perfect, but God understands. And I want to say, what a pathetic way to live. And that it's not the gospel, and it's not Christian living. And God has more for you. God wants more for you, and He wants it to be easy. And the truth is, this concept of easy, it's true of Christian living. It's true in many, many arenas in life, that if you talk to someone who is not successful in something and you ask them, can they do it? They'll say, it's too hard. Take ice skating, for example. Anybody ever tried ice skating? Was it easy or hard? It was nearly impossible for me, and one of the most painful things I ever tried in my life, and it never got easier for me. You know why? I never figured out how to do it. Because if you talk to someone who actually can ice skate and you ask them, is it easy or hard? They'd say, well, if you know you're trying to do some kind of fancy tricks, that might be hard, but just skating around the ice, that is easy. And people who are actually living the disciples' life, the fruit of the Spirit life, the Spirit-filled life, people who are actually living that life, they just say, that's what I'm doing. It's not actually all that hard. But Charles Stanley says, I meet believers all the time whose doctrine can be summarized in two statements: nobody's perfect, and God understands. And at the end of the day, Christian living is either easy or it is impossible. Because in the final analysis, it's not you living it. It's Christ coming and living His life through you and through the power of the Holy Spirit and some other things that we're going to look at. Christian living really can become easy. The truth is, there's far more to Christian living than trying really hard to be good. And I want to say, with all due respect to Charles Stanley's book on the Spirit-filled life, there is more to Christian living than Spirit-filled living. In fact, I got curious about this a few years ago, and I went through the Bible and just read through the Bible, particularly the New Testament, over and over and over again, looking for what the Bible says about how to live the Christian life. Go on to that next slide here. You can see that I found about 15 things. And we're not going to talk, we're going to mention the power of the Holy Spirit first, but we're only going to talk about one of these 15 things today. And that the one is this idea of training. And our key verse is the verse 1 Timothy 4:7 that says, train yourself to be godly, 1 Timothy 4:7. Put the next slide up there if you will. Train yourself to be godly, 1 Timothy 4:7. Can you say it with me? Train yourself to be godly, 1 Timothy 4:7. Let's say it again. Train yourself to be godly, 1 Timothy 4:7. One more time. Train yourself to be godly, 1 Timothy 4:7. Another place we read, it's not actually the same word, but it's a similar concept. 1 Corinthians 9:25 says, everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we will do it to get a crown that will last forever. And this is actually an athletic term. We get our word gymnasium, not from the word that here, but 1 Timothy 4:7, the word that is the underlying Greek word that is used there. It's actually the word we get our gymnasium from that word. And it has to do with a kind of an athletic endeavor. So I'm going to illustrate this a couple different ways, but let's illustrate it this way for starters. Let me ask you, if you were to go out and try to run a marathon today, this afternoon, would that be easy or hard? In fact, most of you would say it would be impossible, right? And what if I said to you, well, what if you tried really hard? I mean, what if I were able to offer you $1 million if you could run 26 miles before the sun went down today? Yeah, you might try, but I'm telling you, if you've never done it before and you're not in the process of running pretty regularly, trying wouldn't help. You would never get there. Just trying really hard would not get you there. But Paul didn't say try really hard to be godly. He said train yourself. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. And he uses, to say, an athletic metaphor, but I'd like to use a different metaphor here, and that is a metaphor of music, all right? So, and my question I'd like to ask you is, would it be easy or hard for you to sit down at this piano right here and play Amazing Grace on the piano? Would that be, you can turn that down if you will. Would that be easy or hard to play Amazing Grace on the piano? Easy or hard? Let me hear you. In fact, you'd say, if you're honest, you'd say, it would be impossible. And I come back with a statement again. Well, what if you tried really hard? What if you bit your lower lip and you said, all right, I'm going to try. What if I offered you $1 million? I mean, if you could get through Amazing Grace, I offered you $1 million to do it. You got 60 seconds to get through one verse of Amazing Grace. Could you do it? No, because not like if you're a piano player, you could. In fact, if you're a piano player, I'm not going to ask your piano player here, but in the first service, I actually asked your piano player to do it. And he came up and he played it really, really, really well. And I asked him afterwards, was it easy? Are you the piano player? Would it be easy or hard for you? It'd be pretty easy, right? Really easy, probably. Why? Because she has trained herself. Not because she tries really hard, but because she has trained herself. And so the question I want to ask you is, what if you trained yourself? Not tried really hard to play Amazing Grace, but what if you trained yourself to play Amazing Grace on the piano? Well, if you're thinking, you would ask the question, well, what in the world does that look like? Well, it looks like this. All right, I want you to get that next slide up. Hold your hands up like this. Can you hold your hands like we're a good charismatic church here, all right, real quick. All right, and if you wanted to train yourself, you would sit down with a skilled piano player, and the skilled piano teacher would number your fingers from 1 to 5 on each hand. So we're going to start in the middle finger, that's middle, right? Yeah, 1, so that's your thumbs, all right? So that's 1, wiggle your thumb real quick, and then this finger, your pointer finger, that's number 2, and the middle finger, that's number 3, and the finger number 4, you feel that? And one of the reasons why we want you to actually do it, you learn by doing. The Bible says we're to be doers of the word because there's something magical about actually doing. And when you actually do this, one of the things you learn is that finger, did you notice? It's actually harder than all the other fingers. It's even harder than the pinky finger. There's something about the muscles in that finger. And a skilled piano teacher would point this out and say, you're going to have to work actually hard on that ring finger because it's for something or reason, whatever reasons about the muscles in that finger, they're a little more difficult. All right, then we're going to give you not Amazing Grace to play. We're going to give you a song that you can play the entire song without moving your hand. All right, you have to move your hands around a little bit to play Amazing Grace. But the whole idea of training is we're going to set the bar really low to something that you can do, and then you're going to do that until that becomes easy. So we're going to start not with Amazing Grace, but Mary Had a Little Lamb, all right? And I want you to take your left hand and put it in your lap, all right? And we're going to work on just one hand at a time. Eventually, we get to two hands, but we're going to work on just one hand at a time, all right? And so and instead of saying the words to Mary Had a Little Lamb, I'm going to say the numbers, all right? So this was 3 and 2, 1. We're going to start there. You ready? 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. Can you do that with me? 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. Let's do it again. Sing along with me. 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. Do it again. 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. Do it again. 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. Do it again. 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. And I ask you to do it over and over because hopefully something is starting to happen. that you actually start to feel that it's getting easier, all right? And you keep working that up, and you take a little break, and then we do the second part. Three, two, one, two, three, three. Hang on, 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3. Oh yeah, here it is. All right. Look at there. All right, the second part is 2, 2, 2, 3, 5, 5. Can you do that with me? That's a voice breaking a little bit. Let's try that again. 2, 2, 2, 3, 5, 5. I can't see your hands, but I trust your hands are doing this right. It's not like a fire or anything. We need to get out of the building. Okay. All right. Okay. Well, there we go. All right. Let's try that again. 2, 2, 2, 3, 5, 5. Do it again. 2, 2, 2, 3, 5, 5. And we do it without me this time. Ready?
2, 2, 2, 3, 5, 5.
All right. So let's do now first and second part together. Ready? 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. 2, 2, 2, 3, 5, 5. Now, notice some of you not playing along, and that's okay. I'd be tempted not to play along either. But I will say to you, if you play along, you're going to start to feel this. You're actually going to feel your body learning something, your hand. All right. And the good news about the third part is it's exactly the same as the first part. All right. So we're going to do the first part and the second part, and we'll go back to the first part, which is the same as the third part. You ready? All right. 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3, 2, 2, 2, 3, 5, 5. 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. All right, now the last part I think is maybe the hardest, but it's 2, 3, 5, 3, 2, 1, 2. Now, I forgot, oh yeah, whatever she just said right there. All right, I should get you to do this for me. It's 2, 3, 3, 3, 2, 1. I think that's right. Let's do the whole thing. We'll figure it out as we go along, all right? I can do it if I get it in context. Here, we start at the beginning, right? 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. 2, 2, 2, 3, 5, 5. 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. 3, 2, 2, 3, 2, 1. All right, now, you did good. Now, if you did that over and over, if you sit down with a skilled piano player, she'd have you do that over. And it's not hard to imagine. I hope you can see it now that you could, if you kept that up, you know, for a few, 5 or 10 minutes, you could actually get where you could play out that tune. And then she'd give you another tune and another tune and another tune. And maybe she'd give you 5 or 10 tunes that you could play with one hand, not having to move that hand. You can play all those songs, all those notes. You don't have to move your hand. And she would go home and she would ask you to go over those songs, those 5 or 10 songs, for 30 minutes or an hour. Day is how much, depending on how fast you want to learn this, but the more time the better. But let's just say 30 minutes or an hour a day, and then you come back and you'd be able to play all 10 of those songs pretty well. And so then she'd give you 5 or 10 more songs, and then next week, 5 or 10 more. And then after a week or two, she would introduce a left hand, and maybe for a week or two, you'd do just the left hand. And then this would be a challenge, kind of a stretch goal, but there'd be another time about a month in there. She would actually have you playing two hands at the same time. Now, at first, this hand would be just doing one note per measure. So this one, da-da-da-da-da-da, and this is just doing one, da-da-da, like that. And so, but then after a while, you'd work out that, and then another month would go by, and she would have you work on two notes in the right hand, so you'd have harmony going, and then you'd get where you're moving your hands around just a little bit, and then she would introduce you to a little music theory, because up until now, it's been all white notes, and so somewhere along the line, you got to figure out how to play well on the black notes and what's involved in that, and sharps and flats and so on like that. She'd introduce you to the notes and quarter notes and half notes and eighth notes and all that, and bars and time signature, and she'd be telling you all about that. And all the while, you're going home every day and practicing 30 minutes or an hour a day. And if you keep that up in about 5 years, you'll be able to play Amazing Grace. And you might be tempted to say, well, that sounds like the hard way. That sounds like a hard way to learn to play Amazing Grace. And I want to argue, no, it is not the hard way to learn to play Amazing Grace. It is the only way to learn to play Amazing Grace. The hard way is to go to that piano right now and try really hard. And that is how many people try to live the Christian life. They hear this great sermon on being a prayer warrior, and they go home and they try really hard, unsuccessfully, and then they just give up over time. And they come and they hear a message about service, for example. And they get really fired up, and Jesus tells a story, acts out this parable in a sense for them, and he washes the disciples' feet, and your pastor waxes eloquent and convicting sermon and so on, and you're really under conviction, and you go home and you say, you know what, I'm going to serve my wife, and I'm going to serve my kids, and I'm going to serve my community, and I'm going to go on a mission trip, and I'm going to serve, and I'm going to try really hard to serve. But then you go to work and you come home and you're tired and this comes up and that comes up and life kind of gets in the way, and after a few days you kind of forget about it, and it leaves you, and I think a lot of Christians have this, with this kind of vague, unfocused feeling of guilt. That I know that there's a high and holy calling up here, and there's a standard up here, and there's something that God wants me to do. And I should be giving, and I should be serving, and I should be praying, and I just need to try hard, and I'm not doing very good. And nobody's perfect, and God understands. And we come around and we hear a sermon on gratitude, and it's Thanksgiving, and we hear a sermon on, and every Thanksgiving you hear somebody say this. You know, we really ought to have Thanksgiving every year. We just ought to be more grateful people than we are. Let's all try really hard to be grateful. I actually preached a sermon on gratitude a few years back and got to that point in my preparation, and I thought, you know what, we need to do better. What if we trained ourselves? What if we trained ourselves to be grateful? And this is an especially important point, because the Bible says, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. And what he's saying is, if you want to have a close relationship, gates is kind of the outer circle, the outer rim, all right? So if you want to come into a relationship with God, we start by that outer circle of entering into his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise. If you study the prayers of Scripture, you discover that nearly every one of them starts with thanksgiving and praise. Jesus taught us to pray, "Our Father in heaven, holy is your name." And it's an expression of worship. And so the beginning of a relationship with God is all about gratitude and praise. And so it's an important point for that reason. And a curious thing about humans in this generation, and that is, we are richer, we are healthier, we are safer, we live longer, we live better, but yet we're less happy, best scientists can study, than any generation before us. And I actually taught on this last week. I ran across this good little quote. He said there's a funny dynamic that goes that a cockroach will ruin a whole bowl of cherries. So if you're eating a bowl of cherries and you found a cockroach in there, you're going to keep eating the cherries? One cockroach will ruin a whole bowl of cherries, but one cherry does little to help a bowl full of cockroaches. And the whole point is, there can be a whole lot of things that are going well in your life. So your health is doing pretty well, and maybe you got enough money to pay your bills, and your grandkids are doing okay, but you got this one little something that's not going well. What are you focusing on? You tend to focus on that thing. And gratitude is God's remedy to that problem. And so at any rate, several years ago, I was going to preach a Thanksgiving message on this, and I got to thinking about it myself. And, you know, one of the things that those of you who are teachers, one of the things you love about teaching is, you know, I can fall asleep through somebody else's sermon, but it's hard to fall asleep through my own sermon. Amen, Pastor? All right, so I always pay attention. That's why I have told my church many times, if I'm going to go to church, I just soon do the talking. Because if I do the talking, I got to pay attention, and it's a great discipleship thing for me personally. But at any rate, so I did this message on Thanksgiving a few years back, and it says in the Bible says, in all circumstances, be grateful. All right, and so I was thinking in the back of my mind about this idea of train yourself to be godly, and my challenge to my people that day was that before you go to bed at night. I don't know what you think about before you go to sleep at night, but I want you to think about 20 things, because you got five fingers on this hand and five fingers on this hand and five toes down here and five toes down here. So use that kind of a prompt. And this hand represents five people, family members, that you're grateful for. All right. So in my case, that's four grandbabies and one other person. And, And maybe it'd be my, I got three kids. So I thank the Lord for my three kids and two daughters-in-law. And maybe the next day at night, I'd think about my two sisters and my one brother and my parents. But every night, I think about five family members. Could be extended family, but just thank you, Lord. And just try to just savor, you know. Thank you, Lord, for Jaden. And thank you, Lord, for Owen. And thank you, Lord, for Emma and Havy. It's my four grandkids. And then, you know, one other person. And then I think, so that's my left hand is five family members and then five other people. All right. Generally speaking, in my world, that'd be church members. So I thank you, Lord, for Sissy. And thank you, Lord, for Richard and Michelle. And thank you, Lord, for Billy and Dita. And what they mean to me and their contribution to the church and so on. So five family members and five other people. And then I would think, my toes down here, I think about five physical things. So thank you, Lord, that you've got air conditioning. Anybody want to live in Georgia sometime before air conditioning? Thank you, Lord, for air conditioning. Thank you, Lord, for the internet. Thank you, Lord, for a smartphone. Thank you, Lord, for a computer. Thank you, Lord, for indoor plumbing. Thank you, Lord, for all that you provide for us. We get food in the pantry and so on. And then the last five is thank you, Lord, for five spiritual blessings. So it could be thank you, Lord, that you forgive me of all my sins. Thank you, Lord, for you've indwelt me with the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for the Bible that you've given us. Thank you, Lord, for the hope of eternal life. So on like that. So every night before I go to bed, I would just thank God for 20 things in four different categories. Could you do that? Could you do that? All right. Could you get to the person where your automatic thought in all circumstances was to give thanks in all circumstances? Well, that's a little harder. But what I want to say is if you train yourself, we start with a low bar. So if you want to run a marathon, we don't start with a marathon. We start with running around the block. You do that every day for a week and then another block and another block. And next thing you know, you could run a little farther. All right. So that's the same idea. All right. So we're going to start with 20 things before I go to bed at night. And I knew this was working a couple years back when a few years back. I played tennis in high school, but really just kind of occasionally since then. But I picked up a racket again a few years back. And I'm not a particularly competitive person, all right? But there's this one guy that just brings out the competitiveness in me. And the reason is I'm not all that great a tennis player, but I do know how to hit a tennis ball. I mean, I could walk you through 12 steps. I'm not going to do it here, but I could walk you through 12 different little checkpoints on a forehand alone where exactly your grip and the unit turn and loop and all this kind of stuff. I won't go through the whole thing here. But anyway, I can tell you exactly how a tennis ball ought to be hit. I know how to serve ought to be hit. I know how you ought to hit a volley that's up in the net. I know how to have backhand a little less than a forehand. But anyway, I understand the gist of how it ought to hit. And this guy that I'm talking about, he did it all wrong. All right, so your pastor understand this, but maybe none of the rest of you will. But he used an Eastern grip to hit a serve. There is nothing that drives a trained tennis player crazier than watching a guy hit a serve with an Eastern grip. Like, what are you thinking? Okay? But magically, somehow, this guy beat me all the time. He did it all wrong, but he beat me, and it just drove me crazy. And one night, though, I was beating him. All right, the score, I was up, probably because we were playing doubles and my partner was better than his partner. Probably had nothing to do with me, but I happened to be beating in this night and I could smell the blood in the water and I was fired up and I was going to take him and at one point in the match, he hit a cross-court volley like nobody's business, went over here just out of reach, but I reached like crazy for that, and it's one of those moments where I'm reaching, and then I realized, it's this like time stands still kind of moment, I realized I have reached so far that my legs will not catch up with my upper body. I'm reaching so far over here that I am going down. And sure enough, I fell down, glasses came off, racket everywhere, and so it skidded up my hands and so on. And there's a reason they call it hard court. Tennis, mostly in America, here's playing on hard court. They call it a hard court, and that's because it's really hard. And if you fall down on it, it hurts pretty bad. But I kind of dusted myself off, started to finish out the match because I wanted to beat this guy. But I thought, you know, in the abundance of caution, maybe I ought to just call it a night. And so I was kind of doing okay. It's a little bit sore, but I thought I was doing okay. Had somebody kind of help me off the court to my car, was able to drive home. told my wife about my sad story, almost beating this guy and so on. But then we just sat down and we watched a show for about half an hour. And I don't know the physiology of what happened during that half an hour, but something deep in my back tightened up. So with it, when I started to move half an hour later, it would be impossible for me to know how much it actually hurts, actually hurts for a woman to give birth to a baby. But I have never in my wildest dreams imagined that it hurt any worse than I felt that night. I mean, it just was blood-curdling scream. I have never, never, never felt such pain in all my life. So just the least little bit of movement caused that kind of pain. And so I'd be still a little again, and we watched another show, and then, you know, I'd try to move again, and once again, just blood-curdling scream. And then I'd try to, well, maybe I just need to work through this. And I just forced myself to move a little bit and thinking maybe it'd get better. It didn't get any better. And, you know, one thing led to another. It's midnight now. My wife's tired of hearing me cry. So she calls 911. The ambulance comes and gets me and hauls me to the hospital and so on. And, of course, that whole ordeal, you know, getting me onto the stretcher and then off the stretcher into the ambulance and then bumpy ride to the hospital and then out of the ambulance onto another stretcher and off that stretcher and all that just terrible, terrible pain. But at any rate, I got onto the hospital bed there in the emergency room and got kind of still for just a moment. And I emphasized the point that as long as I was perfectly still, there was actually no pain, all right? It's just the least little bit of movement, just when all the pain came. And so I'm still there, and I just happened to notice, had my hand down on the bed here, kind of bracing me so I wouldn't move, and I just felt that bed was just about right. It just occurred to me that, you know what, that bed is not too stiff. It's not too, think of it as too soft, that could be uncomfortable. Too stiff, that'd be bad. And then it occurred to me that it was tilted just about right, all right? Because I thought if I was laid all the way back, that could be uncomfortable. And if it was too far up, that could be uncomfortable. And then once those two thoughts hit me, then my training kicked in. So I said, thank you, Lord, for this bed and the stiffness of this bed and the softness of this bed. And thank you, Lord, for the angle of this back behind me. And thank you, Lord, that I don't live too far from the hospital. And thank you, Lord, that we live in a country where you can call 911 and they come and get you and help you and sort out the finances and ask questions later. Thank you, Lord, that I've got a wife to be with me during this time. And thank you, Lord, that there are smart people who went to school for years that are going to help me here for long. And just this whole riff of thank you this, thank you, Lord. And I had a little worship service there in the hospital because I had trained myself. And so my appeal to you, my application to you is, if you want Christian living to be easy, we need to be saved first. We need to understand what it is to be filled with the Spirit. And quite honestly, there's a few other things to do well to understand. But a real key component is that you would train yourself to be godly. That you would find one particular aspect of Christian living. In this case, it's gratitude. It could be a number of things. The Bible says, all kinds of commands, but we take one particular aspect and we select it out and we find something that I could actually do that would be kind of a stretch goal. It'd be a little bit difficult, but thanking God for 20 things is something I could actually do. And you do that every day for, and truthfully, it's about 3 months. It's not 3 weeks. It's about 3 months. You do it every day and before long, it becomes automatic. I mean, it's perfectly easy. That's my appeal to you.